Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Recording. So welcome to the Crypto Day, and Ron, do you want to join us? You're happy there. Okay. I want to point out, though, that, you know, we noticed that we have, we wanted to do affirmative action, so we invited Henry to give a talk as well, since we thought, exactly, so, you know, we didn't want to be thought of as discriminating against men. We're very, very excited with our fantastic speakers and for fantastic results that are going to be presented today. And we're going to start with Tal Malkin, who's going to talk to us about the power of negation.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me, and hi, everyone. So I'm going to talk about the power of negations of in cryptography. And this is joint work with Siyao Guo, Igor Oliveira, who's a student of mine, and Alon Rosen. So the big picture, the big landscape where we start is the question of how simple can crypto be? And this is an old question that people ask since, you know, the beginning of crypto in various ways. This is just two examples. There are various ways you can try to simplify assumptions or complexity. A very successful direction is the depth of the circuit. So Applebaum, Ishai, and Kushilevich showed, which was very surprising at the time, that you could have many cryptographic primitives in NC0, assuming very standard crypto assumptions. And so we will have a different notion of complexity, which I'll talk about, but I just wanted to motivate a little more generally this line of work. And the idea is this. So we look at a restricted, not just all polynomial time computation, but restricted types of circuits, for example, and see what can we achieve crypto in that restricted model. And the goal is if we get a positive result, it's good for crypto. We have efficiency of some sort. Whereas if we get a negative result, it's something for complexity. It's a lower bound. We understand the model better. And this, most of these slides were written, by the way, by Siyao Guo, I forgot to say. And so she wrote this fun to play, but I could not remove it because I agree with it. So the real reason it's really interesting and you can try different things and you can really understand what's going on. So I'll try to motivate more our specific model later, but our model relates to negations, and it starts with monotone cryptography. So I'll define in a minute, but just a few years ago, Goldreich and Izsak asked the question, the first question, as far as I know, about monotone cryptography. So they asked, can one-way functions and pseudorandom generators be computed by monotone circuits? Okay, so let me explain what monotone is and then motivate it. So a normal circuit we can think of as AND, OR, and NOT, with, you know, fan and two AND and OR gates and NOT gates. And we know, assuming any one-way function exists, we can have one-way functions and pseudorandom generators and many other primitives. And they were asking about monotone circuits. So monotone circuits are circuits that have only AND and OR gates, fan and two, without any NOT gates. Okay, so this is a monotone circuit. And what they showed is this. They showed, by the way, interrupt me with any questions or comments, et cetera. So they showed that assuming any one-way functions exist, there exists a one-way function that is monotone. Okay, so you can build a one-way function. If any one-way function exists, you can build a one-way function that has no negations in the circuit. However, they showed that pseudorandom generators cannot exist with a monotone circuit. Such a thing cannot exist. Okay? And I'll show how they showed it, because we extend their results and do other results. And so the way they viewed it, this is a quote from their paper, is that their result showing one-way functions exist in the monotone world, but pseudorandom generators don't, show a gap that doesn't exist in the normal polynomial time world. In the normal world, one-way function and PRGs are equivalent. In the monotone world, there's a fundamental gap, and the way they viewed it is hardness versus pseudorandomness paradigm fails. You can have hardness, but you can not have pseudorandomness. Okay? Yes?
In a constant depth case, there is no separation between one functions and PRGs, but there is two PRFs, right?
So say that again slowly.
So in a constant depth, there is no separation between one functions and PRGs, but but there is a separation.
Right. So here there's a separation even from one-way function to PRGs. So it's one level lower. Yeah, good.
It uniform circuits or not?
Non-uniform. It's all circuit. The whole talk is non-uniform.
Well, you can think of uniform circuits.
Yeah, but this talk is for non-uniform.
Yeah, but yeah, no, my talk, the whole, everything I say in this talk is always non-uniform, including their result and our results as well. I guess I wanted also to say something about, I don't remember if I say it afterwards or not, so I'll say it now anyway, about monotone functions. Yes?
So you're saying that in, are you saying there's no gap between one-way functions and PRG, right?
There is no gap. There is a gap.
They're still equivalent. So when you're looking at constant depth circuits, cryptographic rule is not monotone.
Oh, yes, right.
But there are these results which say, it's talk about NC0 sub 3, NC0 sub 4, right?
With
the Fanon. But there, I don't remember, is there a gap in that? Like
I don't know. Is there a gap between NC03 and NC04 with respect to PRGs and one-way function? I don't know. Does anybody know? I don't know. But this, it's good that you're starting to count, because that's sort of what we'll do here. We'll add, like, monotone is zero knots, and we'll start to count how many negations you have. Good. Okay. So this was their question. And our question is, we have two kinds of questions. One is, how about other primitives? Not why just one-way functions and PRGs? That's what they talked about. What about other primitives as well? And also, even for these primitives and for other primitives, how about circuits with more than one negation? Okay, can there be one negation? Can there be seven negations? Can there be log log n negation? So this is our question. And to motivate it a little bit, so this, the mystery of negation, there's a book by Jukna on the complexity of Boolean functions. And this is the title of one of his chapters. Okay, that's the title of the chapter. And this is very motivating, why we care about negations. This is not about crypto, it's in general. So just to read what he wrote. So the main difficulty in proving non-trivial lower bounds on circuits is the presence of the NOT gates. We already know how to prove even exponential lower bounds for monotone functions without any NOT gates. The effect of such gates and circuit size remains to a large extent a mystery. Okay, so this is his motivation in general, or this is his quote in general. And indeed, these monotone functions were studied a lot in complexity theory and in learning theory. They were not studied much at all in crypto until this result of Goldreich and Izsak. There's a couple other exceptions, but it wasn't a big area. Good. One specific thing. I'll say that later. Okay, good. I wanted to note there's an upper bound by Markov, an old upper bound for any Boolean function. So the number of negations you need for any function, no matter which, is only log n. Okay, it's ceiling of log n plus 1. So he showed that any function can be transformed, any circuit can be transformed to another circuit with only log n negations. So this mystery is, these negations are very, very powerful. With zero negations, we know a lot. Then once you start having negation, we have no idea what to do. And log n negation is already enough for everything. Yeah, I didn't write it on purpose. Markov's result didn't preserve the size, but there were later results that did preserve the size. And this transformation is polynomial. I didn't write it because there are other theorems I cite, and I'm not sure if they preserve the size. This does, for sure. So you can transform in polynomial size. But you know, there are theorems about, by the way, this is true. This theorem is true both for a Boolean function and for a multi-input function. So I like to talk about Boolean functions because we know more about them and I can draw them nicely. Non-Boolean, multi-output function. So you can look at a multi-output function, and this result is still true. So a multi-output function can be computed with log n negation total, not per output bit, but total. So, and this, I'm not sure, for some of the results I'll say later, I'm not sure if they're efficient. But this is efficient for sure. This can be done efficiently. Okay, so this is his result. Log n is enough for everything. So I prefer to talk about Boolean functions when I can, but when you talk about PRGs, for example, it's hard. Good. By the way, so this is what I wanted to say before. Sorry. So the definition of a monotone function, I define monotone function, monotone circuit, right? For a multi-output function, Multi-output function is monotone just if you look at each output bit separately. If that's monotone, then that's monotone. And in general, a characterization with the circuits, instead of the circuits, you could also just say, you know, if you look at the input bits, if you flip one input bit from 0 to 1, the function output can never flip from 1 to 0. Okay, so if x is less than y, then f of x is less than or equal to f of y. That's the equivalent. Good. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to discuss our results. We have a lot of results, but it's basically one story. So I'll discuss, I'll give an overview of all our results, and then I'll go into detail into a little bit, depending on time. Okay, so let's see. So if you have zero negations, that's monotone functions, and this is the result of Goldreich and Izsak. They show that you can do one-way functions and you cannot do pseudorandom generators. Okay, that's what they showed. You can also show that weak pseudorandom functions cannot be monotone, and the reason is that they're learnable. So you could learn, not learnable, monotone. The class of monotone function is weakly learnable, which would imply that weak pseudorandom functions cannot be monotone. Sorry, should I define weak pseudorandom functions? No, it's not. That's a very good point. No, it's not implied. Because that's a very good question. I mean, it is true, so I guess it's implied because truth implies truth. But it's not implied by the result because pseudorandom generators imply weak pseudorandom functions. But the transformation is not, does not maintain the monotonicity. And the reason is that the key is part of, sorry, the opposite, I should have said. Weak pseudorandom functions imply pseudorandom generator easily, right? But the key, so a weak pseudorandom function has a key and an input. Okay, so the key is part of the input, and that's not monotone. So that transformation does not preserve monotonicity. But nonetheless, they cannot be monotone. Okay, Blum, Birch, and Langford's learning results. So weak pseudorandom functions and learning are the opposite of each other. I guess I should define some primitives. I assume you all know one-way function, the pseudorandom generators, pseudorandom functions. Weak pseudorandom functions are like pseudorandom functions where you cannot, the adversary cannot choose the inputs to see the output on, but the inputs are chosen randomly. So namely, an adversary or the attacker, the distinguisher gets examples x and f of x for random x's and needs to distinguish it from random. Okay, and that's much stronger than pseudorandom generators in the sense that you see there's an input and output. So it's like exponentially many. But it's much weaker, I'm just hand-wavingly, much weaker than regular pseudorandom functions because you don't get to choose the input. So we actually don't have results for pseudorandom, weak pseudorandom functions, and it's a very interesting open question. So I'll try to leave time at the end to talk about some open problems. Okay, so we have a lot of results, but we have way more open problems as well. Okay, so we consider these primitives. So as I said, we consider more primitives and also more negations. So there's the primitive of one-way permutation and small bias generators. Let me say something about what they are. We'll see more later. So one-way permutations are like one-way functions, but permutation. In fact, our result is true even for regular one-way function. And small bias generators, I'll talk about later, is like a weaker version of pseudorandom generators. This small bias generators is like a pseudorandom generator that can fool only linear distinguishers. So not polynomial time distinguishers, but only linear. So every linear test does not distinguish it from random. So we showed that these two also cannot be monotone. Now, okay, so these are some primitives we chose, and they also cannot be monotone. One thing that's interesting about the one-way permutation is it is very similar to one-way function in the sense that if you only think about unpredictability versus, you know, hardness, this is hardness, and still it cannot be done in monotone. So it's not just the issue of unpredictability, it's really, yeah.
Mapping from a set to itself.
Yes, but
the identity, which is monotone. Everything else you're
going to have to invert. No, it's not monotone in the sense that if you have an input 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, and the output is some string, then if I flip the first bit from 0 to 1, my output might become smaller. So, if for example f of 0, 0, 0, 0, okay, could be 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. That's a permutation, right? So this permutation from n bits to n bits.
Are you permuting the bits or are you permuting the domain?
No, I'm permuting the domain.
So you've got a set of 2 to the n inputs or something like that.
2 to the n inputs. F from 0, 1 to the n to 0, 1 to the n.
Right.
Okay, and let's assume it's a one-way permutation. So it's conceivable that f of all zeros equals all ones, right? But then but then f of some other vector will have some zeros in it in the output. Whereas a monotone.
In some place, when you flip it, it's going to show non-monotonicity.
Yes, exactly. So
I'm worried about whether these beasts exist. It just say can't exist.
No, I'm saying one-way. I'm saying we've shown that one-way permutations cannot be monotone. One-way functions can be monotone.
Not just identity.
Sorry, I didn't understand the question. No, it has to not just identity. So what we show is every.
Hamming of n-bits to n-bits. That's one to one.
What it has to preserve is the Hamming weight. That's what it means. The only permutations that can be monotone are permutations that permute the bits. I'll show it. But it's interesting because I'll show how they show the one-way functions can be monotone, and you kind of want to try to achieve it as a permutation, but you can't. Yeah. So there are monotone permutations, but they're not one-way. They're easy to invert.
So the statement is that the permutation is monotone. It has to be a permutation of the bits.
That's
And then of course it cannot be
one. Exactly. And I have it on more slides. So this is a high level, and then I'll zoom in. I have zooming in on most of these things, but I'll only cover some of them in the talk. Yeah. No, they don't. So this is a good point. The question was about small bias generators implying one-way functions. It will be a good point in 1 minute in the slide. So you can build, no, not mono. You can build small bias generator unconditionally. Not monotone. You cannot build a monotone at all, because that's one of our results. But you weren't asking about monotone. You were asking about the definition. So when you see this, maybe you would, this is not a formal statement, but you get the idea that maybe cryptography in general is just non-monotone. Nothing is monotone except for one-way functions, okay? Which maybe, I guess, we cannot really put it forward because it's not formal enough, but sort of this is the feeling that you get. Good, so this is for monotone functions. Then we initiate the study of what if you have more than one negation, more than zero negation. What if it's not monotone, but you want to count how many negations it has? So as I said before, Markov showed that log n negations are sufficient for any function, cryptographic or not. Here are some more primitives we examined. So these are four primitives: hardcore bits, extractors, pseudorandom functions, and error correcting codes. I'll give more detail if I get to whichever of those I get to present in a talk. I'll give more detail. But let me just say, in general, what we show. For these primitives, we show this is tight, okay, up to something. So you need at least log n or omega of log n negations in order to be able to compute it. I'll say something a little more accurate in a second. But so for those, we show just that they're not monotone. For these, we show a lower bound. So in particular, for hardcore bits and for extractor, we show omega log n lower bound, so it's tied up to O1 multiplicative term with the Markov result. Good. So when I say extractors, I mean extractors with good extraction properties. Like if extractors with good parameters need at least log n negations. And we also show a similar result, even more tight, for the other two primitives. So we show, in fact, so that the Markov, the exact statement of Markov is log n plus 1 ceiling. And here we show log n minus O of 1. So it's really tied up to additive factors, not just multiplicative factors. For pseudorandom functions and error correcting codes. So in other words, we show pseudorandom functions require at least log n minus O of 1 negations for strong pseudorandom functions, regular pseudorandom functions. And the same for error correcting code. This is not very accurate. It's for error correcting codes with good distance. We have a more accurate statement of trade-off between the number of negations and the best distance you can achieve.
For hardcore bits, you mean just the circuit computing the hardcore bit, or the one-way function and the hardcore bit circuit?
No. So first of all, there could be one-way function that is monotone. based on right. Goldreich result. No, the so here's let me think of a precise statement for hardcore bits. So there exists a family of one-way functions. If any one-way functions exist, then there exists a family of one-way functions such that any hardcore bit, any general hardcore bit constructions you have requires at least log n bits. So it's true that like most significant bit is a hardcore for some functions if you believe some assumptions, and that's monotone. So we don't negate that. We say there's not like gold, if you look at Goldreich-Levin, that's a general construction. It's all XORing things, which is a good time to say the following: XOR and negation are the same if you just count how many, because you can translate any negation to some little circuit with a single XOR, and any XOR to a little circuit with a single negation. And if you look, for example, at Goldreich-Levin hardcore bit, it has a lot of XORs in there. And this is sort of saying, oh, can we achieve it without any with fewer negations, not many negations? Well, it has linearly many negations, and you could do it with log n by Markov. So we show that you cannot have a general hardcore bit that works for any family of one-way functions with less than log n bit. It could be, if you believe RSA, that most significant bit is a hardcore function. Yes?
So maybe you said it and I missed. So
no problem.
There's a difference between monotone functions and functions that can be computed by small monotone circuits, right?
Right.
The results are...
Yeah, so if I want to be conservative, our results are for polynomial-sized circuits. But in fact, I think many of us, so definitely the results for one-way permutations that don't matter, the efficiency doesn't matter. Ask me about each result separately. I need to think about it. So we state all the results for polynomial-sized circuits. But in fact, some of them are true even without any efficiency constraints. Like maybe even all of them. I'll think as I give them. Definitely for one-way permutation, arbitrary. There is no one-way permutation. Because of what we said before, it's unrelated to the complexity of how large is the circuit. Good. Okay. So once you see this gives the idea that many primitives are highly non-monotone, right? Like these are maximally non-monotone. And we don't know the answer for the other ones. Maybe they also are maximally non-monotone, but we don't know how to prove it. So I wrote these two things here because my talk will be basically divided into a bunch of results on the left side and a bunch of results on the right side. So showing that crypto in general is non-monotone except one-way function, and showing many primitives are highly non-monotone. And I'll go into details of the proof into some of them. You could think that maybe all of crypto is highly non-monotone. So we show one upper bound. The only upper bound we managed to show is this. So for small bias generators, we show that any super constant number of negation is sufficient. Okay, we have an upper bound, some construction that we prove works. So any super constant, for example, log star, log, log, log star, log star, log. Anything that's super, any even very small, is sufficient. Now, this doesn't really contradict this, because now going back to your question, you can say maybe small bias generators, they're not really crypto. You can achieve them unconditionally, and you know they're not secure against polynomial time adversaries. So maybe still you could kind of have the philosophy that all of crypto is highly non-monotone. But I'm not sure. Because all the rest, everything else that's empty here, we have no idea. Okay. The construction is unconditional. Yeah, the construction is, I actually wasn't going to talk about it, but it's simply XOR of the tribe function. Even XOR of majority would work with like worse parameters. The best parameters we found is like XOR of tribes, and tribes is like OR of ends. It's some specific function. So the XOR is the only negation, but it's multi, so it's a bunch of negations because it's a fan in more than two. So that's the construction for small bias generators, and it's unconditional, but only against linear tests. Good. So we leave open ridiculously basic questions, like can you have a one-way permutation with a single negation? Can you have a PRG with a single negation? Like, it seems the answer should be no, but I don't know. Can you have a weak PRF with a single negation? We don't know the answers to that. Okay, these seem like very, so hopefully you guys will figure out.
I
Maybe you did.
Circuit lower bounds known for one negation? Like
say that again?
Are there any circuit lower bounds known for one negation?
Not that I know. And I know people have thought about it in the context of weak pseudorandom functions because it's equivalent to learning. So I know people try to learn, you know, function classes with a single negation, and it's not known. But I'm not sure about other results. I don't think so. So I'm not a big expert on this, but both Igor and Siyao are. So I assume there aren't any results that I don't know about, or else they would tell me. But tell me if I'm wrong. Yeah.
So the proofs are in any sort of monotone reduction?
So what do you mean?
I'm talking about if I want to prove one negation.
Yeah.
Does it suffice for me to prove that small bias, pseudorandom generally cannot exist, and I will prove weak pseudorandom function because you show that weak pseudorandom function imply pseudorandom generally with monotone reduction?
No. The only thing that's trivial is that pseudorandom generators imply small bias generator with monotone reduction that does nothing. So that's trivial. But the other things, no, I don't know how to do, and they're not trivial. And in fact, one of the open problems I wanted to mention is monotonicity of reduction, which we don't address here at all. But since you ask now, I'll say, like, think about the GGM construction of PRF from PRG. Okay? Even if you take the PRG as a black box and you think of it as you don't count it against monotonicity, the reduction itself has linearly many negations because every time you say, oh, if x equals 0, go left, if x equals 1, go right, it's a negation in there. So they have many negations, and I don't know, it might be interesting to see, can we build PRF from PRG in a monotone way? I don't know. So there's lots of, this work is brand new, and there's lots of open things that might even not be too hard, I don't know, but I think some of them are definitely hard. Like, I think the understanding the weak pseudorandom functions seems hard somehow, when all the results you have always just don't apply to weak PRFs, in my experience. That seems hard, but other results might not be so hard, and they're definitely interesting, in my opinion. Okay, good. So I'm going to talk about a bit the cryptography is non-monotone and about the many primitives are highly non-monotone. And I'll try to give an idea for our techniques, because maybe they could be used for something else. So let's see. So I wanted to show you, like, just give you an idea of how all these results are proved, because they're all fairly simple. Okay, so this is the result of Goldreich and Izsak, who showed that if one-way functions exist, then monotone one-way functions exist. So I just wanted to show it to you, even though it's not our result. So the general structure is, given any one-way function, they only look at the middle slice, which I'll define in a minute. And that middle slice must be a monotone weak one-way function. Okay, that is computable by a polynomial time circuit. And then the weak one-way function implies regular one-way function. That reduction is monotone. Okay, so what is this middle slice? So if you think, no, there are ways with you just yeah, no. Yeah, you just concatenate them. So let me say, what is the middle slice? So, you know, if we want monotone, basically we want, if something is of a if x has a lower Hamming weight than y, then f of x has less than or equal Hamming weight than f of y, something like that. So if you think of the Boolean, if you slice the Boolean cube based on the Hamming weight of, you know, all the vectors of Hamming weight 0, all the vectors of Hamming weight 1, the middle slice are, let me maybe open it. This size of x means it's the Hamming weight of how many ones. These are x is zeros and ones. So the middle slice is just all the strings with n over 2 ones and n over 2 zeros, okay, of Hamming weight n over 2. That middle slice, you can give any values that you want. It will never contradict monotonicity. Okay, the only way to contradict monotonicity by definition is to go, if you have something lower and something higher, and the something lower has value 1, and the something higher has value 0, then the function is not monotone. So what this suggests is take any function, any one-way function that you want. F goes from n bits to n bits that you assume is one-way function, if any one-way function exists. Then look just at all the vectors that have Hamming weight n over 2, and define the function there as it was before. Everything with higher Hamming weight, the function always outputs 1. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. And everything with lower Hamming weight, the function always outputs 0. Okay? So this is the construction. And they claim it's a weak one-way function and it's monotone. It's very easy to see that it's monotone, like any function that has 1s in the upper half and 0s in the lower half is monotone. It's a weak one-way function because there are many vectors with the Hamming weight n over 2. So there is a non-negligible fraction of inputs that are hard to invert.
I'm sorry, going back to all the
questions. Yeah.
Of course, you can compute this by an efficient circuit. You just, you know, you check if x is, you know, the Hamming weight, and if so, you just compute f. Otherwise, you output 0, 1. But
no, it needs to be efficient. It needs to be monotone.
Efficient without negation?
Yes, so they show this. This is not trivial. It's not obvious, but they that's what they did.
Why did you seem to compute the Hamming weight first? And,
no, even
otherwise it's f.
Yeah, but f is not monotone.
Right, you can.
But f is monotone if you only look at
as a circuit
is not monotone. Right, so this is not trivial, but this is what they did. Yeah. It's not trivial, but this is what they did. This function is monotone. The circuit you get for f is not monotone. It could be anything. So they converted it to a monotone, efficient monotone circuit for this function. Yeah.
So if you have a monotone function, there is a monotone circuit that could be big. In fact, there's a monotone.
Right, exactly. Every monotone function has a monotone circuit that could be big. But here they show that the transformation has polynomial overhead. So if it was polynomial, it remains polynomial. Okay?
It's not a general thing. Like, if you have an efficient non-monotone circuit for monotone...
No, it's not a general thing. It's not a general thing. And because there are circuit complexity lower bounds for monotone...
I see. But there exist for functions for which you know the monotone circuit exists, but it has to be there.
Yes. Yes, exactly. And that's also related to the question Vinod asked before about the Markov's thing. It's related to what Vinod asked before about Markov's thing, Markov's transformation from any function to a function with log n negations. That transformation can be made efficient. Okay, I think maybe it was Fisher, or I don't know who proved it. Okay, so the question is, can we show that one-way permutation exists, imply that monotone one-way permutation exists? And we already, I guess, discussed it before, and the answer is no. And this is the claim I said before. So the claim is, the only way you get a monotone permutation if you actually permute the bits, namely you maintain the Hamming weight, okay? So that's the only possible monotone permutations. Okay, and then once you if you believe this theorem, then definitely no such function could be hard to invert, because here is how you invert: you take this vector that has all zeros except for 1, 1. You apply the function on it. You see where the 1 moved. Then you know what the permutation did with that bit. You do it n times. You know exactly what the permutation is. So it's very easy to invert any function that just permutes the order of its bits, right? If it's easy to compute, it's easy to invert. So that's like this characterization is sufficient. I mean, immediately implies that there's no monotone one-way permutations. Okay, so you can prove this in two ways. We give two proofs. One is a combinatorial proof, which is just, you know, you can prove by induction on the Hamming weight, and you look at the structure. It's not too hard. And the other proof is analytic proof, which I actually want to show, because these tools are kind of similar and will be used in other results that we do later. It also extends regular one-way function. It's simple, but it does rely on some previous theorems, which I will state. Whereas the first result doesn't rely on anything. It's elementary, but it just would take a little longer to write. But this is my theorem. So I'm going to show an analytic proof, okay, which will help me introduce also other techniques for later. Yes? So this is what I want to prove, this theorem on top. If f is a monotone permutation, then the only thing it can do is just permute the order of its input bits, not anything more complex. OK. So this is what we're going to use. So let me start this way. So We will, these are some well-known techniques that we will use. So one inequality that's known is that for any two monotone functions must be positively correlated. What does it mean positively correlated? So I'm talking about Boolean functions from n bits to 0, 1. If I say probability, there was a pointer here, probability fx equals 1 and gx equals 1, well, that equals probability fx equals 1 times probability gx equals 1 given fx equals 1, right? And the claim is that this is greater than or equal the probability fx equals 1 times probability of gx equals 1. That basically means that they're positively correlated, that if you already know that fx was equal 1, g is more likely to be equal 1. And this is true for every monotone function. And moreover, we won't exactly use this. We will use something even stronger. OK, so it's clear what this means? Good. So that will be useful for us. The other thing that will be useful for us is a way to bound exactly how much bigger, how big the correlation is. So here's Talleyrand's inequality. So it says exactly the same as above plus something, which we'll talk about the something in a minute. So the probability that fx equals 1 and gx equals 1 is greater than probability fx equals 1 times probability gx equals 1 plus some function phi of something that's going on here. So let's see what is that. So a very important thing we will use is this IIF. Okay, this is the influence or the sensitivity of f to variable I. It's defined as follows. IIF is the probability over all the x's that you compute f of x, and then you flip. This means you flip the ith bit of x, and you check the result. What's the probability that it changed? Okay, this is sort of the sensitivity of f to location I. Okay, the influence of bit I on f. And you can think about it that somehow, I don't know, if it's a constant function, then this probability is 0. It never flips. Okay, and if the function is f of x equals x7, then I7 of f is 1, whereas I everything else of f is 0. So you can think about it. And there are, so in fact, for monotone functions, we know that there must exist a variable that's pretty influential, but I'll talk about it later. So this is IIF, okay? I sub I of f. So here we compute this is the sum over all I from 1 to n. I compute the sensitivity of f to location I times the sensitivity of g to location I, and I sum them up. And after I finish summing them up, I'm putting them through some other function phi, which is whatever, does something. We'll use it when we need it. But it's some constant times z over log of e over z. So okay, the bigger it is, the bigger phi is. OK, so basically, it doesn't really matter. But what matters is that the influence is important. And also, they have to be influencing in the same location. OK, so we will see how we will use that. But this is a very powerful tool we'll use in other results as well. And it's Talleyrand's inequality.
Sorry,
yeah,
sorry.
One of them.
For monotone function, the influence.
There exists an I, yeah.
So it's for any like non-constant one. So of course for constant functions.
For constant function, the it's zero. Yes, you're right.
So, but for any, you're saying for any non-constant function, you have
It's log n over n, I think. Yeah, it's log n over n.
For
yes.
For non-constant monotone function, there exists an I.
Yeah.
Exactly,
yeah, which I don't need right now, but I will need later. OK, so we will use these. So what do we do with them? So like using these theorems, you can very easily prove the theorem I mentioned before about the permutations. So how do we prove this now? Let's go here. So f is a multi-output function. Let's think of, like, you know, fj is the jth output bit. And we'll talk about we'll look at the correlation between the jth output bit and the kth output bit. Okay, so this I just rewrote the same thing before with fj and fk instead of f and g. Okay, so this is the probability that fj of x, the jth output equals 1 and the kth output equals 1, is greater than equal than all this. Well, however, if you think about it, since f is a permutation, this probability is over x, right? Since f is a permutation, it goes over all possible x's. Okay, so the output goes over all possible outputs. And so every pair is equally likely with the same probability. Therefore, the probability that J is not equal to K, yes. For every J not equal to K, F of J equals X and F of K equals X, but the probability is quarter because any combination is will be equally likely. And for the same reason, F of J equals 1 is half, and F of K equals 1 is half. Yes? And therefore, this whole thing was 0. Okay? It must be 0. Okay? Which is good, because then the whole thing will fall. So, I also didn't say this phi function is such that if phi of z equals 0, then z must be equal 0. Okay? So therefore, the thing inside here is also equal 0. Good. So what does it mean it equals 0? It means whenever variable I has any influence on fj, then that variable has no influence on fk, because it's all every one of these things is 0. Okay? So for every I and n, iif times ii, the influence of the ith variable on fj and times the influence of the ith variable on fk is 0. Okay? And what does it mean, the influence? This means that fj and fk depend on disjoint input coordinates. Because if fj depend in any way on x3, then it means fk does not depend on x3 at all. Okay? So they each depend on different ones. And we have n of them, n output bits, f1 to fn. Each one depends on disjoint coordinates. There are only n coordinates to go around, which means each one depends on just one coordinate. Yeah, and I guess, that's it. Each one depends on exactly one input coordinate, which proves the theorem, right? Because then it must be, what does it mean depends on input coordinate? So if F7 depends on X3, that's the permutation. So it just, it depends on it. Only on one of them. Okay, so this is a proof. So once you know this inequality, the proof is very easy. The other proof is also very easy. I guess Ron saw it right away. All right. Good. So this is a proof of the no. I agree. okay, good. Okay, so that's the end of the proof of this theorem, of that result. And we also, along the way, introduced this Talleyrand inequality and working on thinking about influence of a certain variable for a certain Boolean function, which we will use later. Okay. Wow. My God. Okay, let me skip. I didn't realize it was so late. So when do I need to end? I want to make sure to talk at least 2 minutes about open problems. Ten past. I know I have too many slides. I'll decide what to skip, so don't worry about it. Okay, so monotone PRGs and SVGs. I wonder if I should skip it. Basically, I guess I can show you the this. There is an X there, not monotone. There exist no monotone PRGs or small bias generators. Okay, so basically, let me think what to say so that it's both coherent and short. What Goldreich and Izsak did is they just showed if you had, for any function from n bits to n plus 1 bits that purports to be a PRG, they actually showed if the function happens to be monotone, then you can actually distinguish it from random. They built a concrete distinguisher that distinguishes any such function from random with this probability. And their distinguisher was very simple. The distinguisher just either outputs one of the bits of the output or outputs an AND of two of the output bits. That was their distinguisher. Okay? Good. So let me think about this. Doesn't matter. Their distinguisher is an AND of two bits. And we basically show that using the same approach, you could, instead of doing AND of those two bits, you can do XOR of those two bits. And XOR is a linear function. Okay? And therefore, it couldn't be SBG. Okay? And the very similar proof works. And the proof exactly uses this influence and Talleyrand inequality. I can go through it, but maybe it's better to go through something else. I don't know. Okay, so that's the high-level view. They built their result. The way they prove their result is based on exactly those theorems I showed before.
So, you said the distinguisher is an AND of two bits. Which
did they say? Yes, here is the bits. Okay, I'll tell you what it is. So, Good. So I have n plus 1 output bits, right? Because it has to be expanding. It's any expanding monotone function. So think of f1 to fn plus 1. Now use the fact I said before. Think of each bit separately. Every monotone function has a most influential variable. That's what I said before. So choose two of, by pigeonhole principle, there are only n variables and n plus 1 bits. There are two of them that have the same coordinate. Yeah, it was log n over n. I was right. Good? So there must be two outputs. This is their proof so far. There must be two outputs that have the same, two output bits such that the same input bit I has influence at least log n over n on both j and k. Okay? Just because for j, there exists, for each one, there exists some coordinate, so just choose by pigeonhole principle, there are two of them must agree. Okay? And so, therefore, the product of these two things is log n over n squared. Okay? And therefore, the sum is also at least log n over n squared. I didn't change anything. And if you plug in the definition of phi, you get like some log n is canceled and it's log n over n squared. You can just the definition of phi. And so you get that for these two j and k, so this is how you choose the two j and k. You need to figure out what is the influential, which two have the same influential variable. Oh, and by the way, all of this was assuming they're balanced. Balanced means have equal probability of 0 and 1. If they're not, if some bit is not balanced, just output that bit as your distinguisher. So here is their algorithm. Look at the output. If any of the bits is a good distinguisher already, great, output it. If none of them is a good distinguisher on its own, there must be two that could be ended together as a distinguisher. Because probability of fj equals 1 and fk equals 1 is greater than quarter plus whatever I got here, which is noticeable. Right? So the important thing is that it's noticeable, whereas for random function, this is 0. If f was a random string, it would be 0.
Oops. Mm-hmm.
It only holds for monotone functions. Does it hold only for balance functions? Yeah, you might. That might explain the Yael's question about the if it's a constant. So maybe it's not for every constant monotone function, but only for balance one. I'm not sure. But reverse engineering, it makes sense. Yeah, because exactly. So whatever your definition of distinguish is, it doesn't have to be exactly. So this is their proof, not ours. And we basically proved that actually you can also output. So they output the end, assuming it's balanced. We noticed that you can actually output the XOR, and that also is good. Okay, so we need a little more in the proof, but not much more. Okay, so this is what they got, which we will use as well. We use the other. We use this. The fact, you know, I wrote this before without the extra, without bounding how big the correlation is. If two monotone functions must be positively correlated, well, also anti-monotone functions, right? So in other words, if you have monotone function, the probability that fj equals 0 and fk equals 0 is also greater than the probability that fj equals 0 and fk equals 0 times fk equals 0. And so if you put them together, fj XOR fk is exactly the probability that fj equals 1 and fk equals 1 plus the probability that fj equals 0 and fk equals 0. So for one of them, you get this complicated thing. And for the other one, you get just a simple quarter is enough. I don't need to show the bound. And this is good because for a random function, the XOR should have probability half. So basically, we show that you can extend their proof to have a linear output, a linear distinguisher. Okay, and so that's that result. Yeah. Okay. So let me think what. So yeah.
The non-uniform here is just to see if the function is balanced.
Is just to see if the function is balanced.
Yes.
Let me see. No. I don't know. No. Wait. Yeah, that's a good question. Where is the non-uniformity? No, but if...
But you might balance out the different I-chase.
What do you mean?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't see what's... that's a good question.
Inverse polynomial, I will get them correct, and I will get again inverse polynomial.
Yeah, you can apply it. Yeah, I don't know what's not, but I do remember they're not uniform.
I guess the balance condition, right? You just wanna.
But you can. Why can't you test the balance, right? You can just run the function.
How do I do it?
The almost balance is good enough for me.
I don't know how to run the function with.
Oh yes, of course. But it does. Okay. Good, yeah. So you're saying, yeah, good. Testing is not a simple function. Yeah, you're right.
I guess it's because of the balance, because I can't run the function.
You can run it, but in polynomial time.
Yes.
You can just run it in whatever the complexity of the function is. Times n. Interesting. But, you know, I don't know if they really need the nc0. Why do they? But it wouldn't be linear, and it also wouldn't be as simple as theirs. It wouldn't be an NC0. Even if you just care about their result, it indeed wouldn't be an NC0. Yeah, you could run the function many times and test. OK, so I wanted to say some things about how we prove. So we have, if you remember our results, this was just non-monotone. Then the bulk of our results is showing lower bounds that you need many, many, like for example, for PRFs, you need logarithmically many negations. So let me, here is what, we'll, so the this Talleyrand inequality, which we used before, doesn't work here anymore. It doesn't help us. But we have three general, this is what I'll do. So we have three general statements that we use, three general tools that we use for various results. So I'll give you an overview of these three tools and an example for each of them. Okay? So I think I have time to do the first one in some detail, and that's the PRF one. And then I'll quickly go over the other two. Okay? So we prove some structure results for functions with negations, and then we apply them to get some of our results. Good. So Markov's theorem, this is a different theorem from before. This is a theorem, not only can log n negations are enough, but in fact, he actually quantifies how many negations in terms of the alternating complexity of the function, which I'll define now. So consider a chain. These are each vectors of length n bits, x1 to xl, that are a monotone chain, okay? This is less than or equal. A monotone chain, and look at f of x1 to f of xl, okay? That's the, so if, for example, if the function is monotone, then this, the output is all a monotone chain as well. But this theorem is for general functions, not for monotone functions. So you define the alternating number of x of this vector with respect to f. It's the number of times, if you look at this, how many times the value of f flipped. It's a Boolean function. F is a Boolean function. You look at f of this, f of this, f of this. You know, if it flipped from 1 to 0, from 0 to 1, you look at how many times it alternated. Okay? And what Markov showed is that if you can implement f in a circuit with t negations, okay, then the maximum alternating complexity, it's called, is 2 to the t. So the maximum over all x, no matter which chain you take, would never alternate more than 2 to the t times. Okay? So for example, if t equals 0, that's a monotone function, it alternates one time. You could have 0, 0, 0, and at one point it starts being 1, 1, 1, but it couldn't go back. But he proved it more generally with any t negations. And if you think about it in the contrapositive is if you have, you know, capital T alterations, then you must have at least log of capital T negations. Okay, so if you manage to somehow come up with any monotone chain of inputs such that the outputs flip from 1 to 0 some capital T times, then it means any implementation of the function must have at least log n, log T, log capital T negations. Okay, and using this theorem, we prove the PRF result. Okay, so good. So here is a theorem. The theorem can be strengthened. I'll show how. But this is the theorem for the PRFs, and we prove it using that result. Okay, yeah.
You're saying,
Yeah.
There cannot be monotone circuits. Forget polynomial time, right? Polynomial size.
Yeah.
With little log n negations.
Right.
And there is a polynomial size circuit with omega log n.
Yeah, because but that's not because it's PRF, but because right. anything
it's
has. Yeah, and this is tied up to additive factor. It's like log n minus 1. Okay, and the way we do it is we show given any function, this we'll parse it in a minute, again, any function, no matter what you want, we build a concrete distinguisher that finds some alternating, any, given any function that has at most t, so let's see, here's the theorem. So this is maybe the weakest form of the theorem, but the simplest one. So I think of a PRF, there's the seed and the input, and then let's think of one bit output. And I'm saying it must have at least log n minus O1 negations, even if you guarantee small amount of security, like if you cannot distinguish. So poly n is the distinguisher, and the third is the distinguishing probability. So we build a concrete distinguisher. Here is the concrete distinguisher. So you give me any function that has t negations, okay, that has any t negation that's less than this. Yeah, I'll say that in the next. It doesn't matter. I'll say that in the next slide. I mean, it matters maybe for the third. Maybe you need different parameters. Yeah. So for any F, not just key hardcoded, but for almost every single key. So basically, this is a distinguisher. Okay, the distinguisher works for a specific F with a specific key, and it distinguishes. So for F to be pseudorandom, you want almost an overwhelming fraction of the keys to have at least log n minus O1. So the question, I'll say it again next on the next slide because it's there. So here's the distinguisher. So you just find any chain. So here is an example chain, but you can take any chain that is monotone, increasing monotone of inputs, x0, x1 up to xn. So you take a chain. So for example, you know, you just keep adding ones. And you call f on that, okay? And you check how many times it flipped the output. If the output was like flipped linearly many times, you guess that it's random. Otherwise, you guess that it's pseudorandom. This is a concrete distinguisher. Okay? And then to analyze the distinguisher, you can tell, let me see. You can just, you know, for a random function, it will flip, in random function, these are just n random values, so it will flip about n over 2 times. Okay, we analyzed it exactly, but it will flip about, right, n over 2 times, something like that, because it's just a random function. Whereas if you had less than log n negations, t minus little omega of 1, less than log, if you had t negations, it can flip at most 2 to the t times, for any t, it can flip at most 2 to the t times. And if t is small, then it has to flip less than linearly many times. Okay, so any function that has few negations, cannot have many flips on anything that you take. And I wanted to note some things. So first of all, this is a very simple distinguisher. It's non-adaptive, like you know exactly what you ask for. It applies also for non-adaptive PRFs. But it doesn't apply for weak PRF, because if in weak PRF you get random Xs, and it's even if you do many, many, many examples, it's highly unlikely that you'll happen to get a chain. Because most examples are close to the middle layer, have like Hamming weight about n over 2. You won't get a chain of n things. So this is why this result doesn't apply to weak PRF, but it applies to non-adaptive PRFs. It doesn't depend on the given circuit for F. You know, I just need to test the output of F. So it's not, I don't need to look at the implementation that the designer had in mind. You know, if somebody gives me a function and asks me to check if it's pseudorandom. So one can think of this as some test you should do if somebody suggests some fancy new AES. Try this test. I mean, hopefully nobody will suggest one that doesn't work like that. But you see how many times it flips. Yeah, because the Markov theorem is true regardless. And this is Daniel's question. So I phrased the theorem for F that, you know, a single circuit that takes the key and the input. But you can think of it as a family of many circuits with a key built in, and it still would apply. So that's what I said before. Good. And now that I have two more tools, and this I will just do a high level, but the tools might be helpful for other results. So here are two. So this was the tool of Markov's theorem, okay? The negation, the alternating complexity. That was the tool. Another tool, so the next two tools have to do with, given any function that's not monotone, I can break it into a bunch of functions that are monotone that are connected in a certain way. So there are two structural results of this form. The first result is the result of Eric Blay and Clement Canon and Igor Oliveira and Rocco Servidio and Liang Tan. Good, which proved the following. If F can be computed by T negation, then you can write F as H of G1 up to GT, okay, where all the G's are monotone. Capital T is 2 to the T. So if F has T negations, you can write it as a combination of 2 to the T monotone functions. And the combination H is not monotone, but it's very simple. It's just XOR, parity, or its negation. Okay, so they proved that. This is sort of the proof. I'm going to skip it. I'm going to skip it, but I'll say that the way they proved it is sort of they look at the influence of a function, and if there's, they prove that if you have large influence, it requires many negations. Okay, I'll skip the proof.
There's nothing about the circuit size over there. Like, F could be no. A small circuit, just could be huge.
It stopped moving. Yeah, there is nothing about the size of the circuit. The next result, the circuit is small and nice. Uh-huh. Here, there's nothing about this. So this G could be huge. That's exactly right. Yeah. Good. So in general, where can you use this tool? Whenever there's something that relates to large influence versus small influence. So our application, so there are, our applications were for extractors and hardcore bits. Both of these things were already known that you cannot do them in a monotone way. In previous work, it was known that you can't do them in monotone way. And we showed that they require omega log n negations using, you know, these previous work showed that you require large influence, and now we have this connection between the influence and the number of negations, so we show that you require log n negations. And there might be more applications. So in general, whenever you have any lower bound, that somebody else proved some sort of lower bound that only used the influence, like something like saying, oh, hardcore bits require a large influence, then you could possibly plug our result in and get a lower bound. So that's one structural result of theirs. And so that result could be translated to something more efficient, which kind of led us to the third tool. So the third tool and the second tool are very similar. It's sort of, the second tool that I showed, G could be big. And then we try to maintain the circuit size, and we came up with this tool. So what is this tool? That's another way to decompose a function into monotone functions. So so what is this? So for any function with T negations, you can build a tree of depth T, okay, where each node is a monotone function. I'll show an example in the next slide for one negation, which is clear. So each function can be described as follows. And here the sizes are maintained to be small, polynomial. So you first apply some monotone function to x. And if it's 0, it's a selection function. Then you go left. If it's 1, you go right. Or then when you went left, you apply another monotone function to x. If it's 1, you go here. And like this, you apply t in a selection. You apply t monotone functions. And at the end, you output some other monotone function of x. So just to show you the example with a single negation, that's the same thing as the previous slide, but when t equals 1. If you have a function with a single negation, then every output bit can be described as follows, can be described as h of three things, all of which are monotone. So it's basically if then else. Okay? Any function with one negation can be described as if then else, where everything else is monotone. Okay? So you have you apply a monotone function to x. If it's true, you apply another monotone function to x. If it's false, you apply a third monotone function to x. Okay? So and this is easy to prove. You just look at the circuit, and you look at the one single negation, and you call everything under it like a monotone function, and you call everything over it another monotone function. And it's easy to prove. And then using that and recursively, you prove the previous thing with T negation. OK, so this we use for error correcting codes. I'll also skip. It's in the paper because let's skip the proof idea. Let's skip this. good. I wanted to have like 1 minute to talk about the open problems. So this is a summary of our results, of the techniques. I think I talked enough about our results. I wanted to say there are many open problems, and here are some of them. So one is negation complexity of one-way permutation, the pseudorandom generator. Say with one negation, two negation, we know nothing. We only know they cannot be monotone. Okay, and we have some results that they're actually not in the paper. That's lower bounds about only if the negations are specific, like a negation are only in the bottom layer, then you can prove more lower bounds. It's like it's less powerful. But we don't have any results for arbitrary negation on the circuit. Okay, the weak PRF I feel is very interesting. First of all, it's related to learning, as I said. So if you prove a lower bound, or if you prove an upper bound for weak PRF, then it's hardness of learning. And vice versa, and we don't know if there's a weak PRF with one negation, right? And a strong PRF requires a lot, and weak PRF, we have no idea. And also, it's not hard to prove that you cannot, constant negations are not enough if they're all in the bottom. But if you don't care about the location in the circuit, we have no idea. This is unrelated to our work at all, other than it's interesting to discuss negation complexity. But here is, think about AES or anything, or you know, any PRF, for example. They actually don't have log n or you know Goldreich-Levin, all the construction, GGM, all the theoretical construction, and all the practical construction. They don't have log n negations, even though log n are enough. Okay, they have many more. They have lots and lots of negation. And sure, you can. So why does AES have so many negations? I don't know. XOR is easy to do in hardware. But somehow it seems maybe there's some underlying reason. Maybe one could prove a lower bound. So the Markov is an upper bound of log n. But what if I only looked at very efficient circuits, at like constant depth, you know, AC0 circuits, or even logarithmic depth circuits? Can I say, I have no idea, but it just seems interesting to me. Can I say something about, then log n is not enough, then you need linearly many negations. Maybe that will explain the situation. The GGM has linearly many negations, for example.
So
yeah.
Does Markov work for NC1? In other words, it does take NC1.
So Markov doesn't work for NC1. I think there are some results about that relate the height. There are some results about NC1 versus the negation complexity, but they're not sufficient. I don't remember what they are. There's not much. Markov doesn't work. Markov is not NC1. Yeah. So the last thing I wanted to mention, which we mentioned before, is the negation complexity of reductions, which also we didn't think about, but could you define, you know, a reduction given one primitive, can I build another primitive in a completely monotone way? Like, does PRG imply PRF in a monotone way? I don't know. So I think there's lots of interesting things here to look into, and I want to note that these results, the results we did show are unconditional, so I think it really allows you even, you know, you might ask who cares about the number of negations, but I think it really helps you understand what is going on and what, understand those primitives, the pseudorandom primitives. So, and of course, there are many other primitives one could think about, which might be interesting. Yeah, so that's it. Sorry, ran 5 minutes late. Any other questions?
They're both also not constant depth, very not constant depth, right?
Yes, but okay, right, they're not constant depth, but GGM is linear depth, right? And GGM, everything is open. It's also interesting, like, why does it, like, can we improve the depth? You can ask not just negation complexity, the depth, the number of calls to the PRG is linear. Everything is linear, and there's no improvement. Like, all the improvements are based on stronger assumptions. So GGM is the best known for PRG to PRF, and it's very inefficient in many ways. I'm not sure how to fix it. So this is just a suggestion. The idea is, can we prove that circuits with certain efficiency or certain other constraints must have much higher lower bound? And I wrote AC0 because that seems like something concrete I can write as a question. I'm not quite sure what to write as a question, but my real question would be, explain why AC... Yeah, NC1... No, but okay, there are PRFs in NC1, but they're not, okay, yes, there are PRFs in NC1 based on specific assumptions, right? Like DDH. It's not from one-way functions.
Yeah. negation. That's right, sure. But if Markov applies for NC1, you can convert it to another entropy with log n negation.
No, no, wait, but NC, we don't have PRFs in NC. We have PRFs in NC1 only based on concrete assumptions. Oh, you're willing to make assumptions, okay. I'm like all these like assumptions nowadays in crypto, like PRFs, it's like too much for me. It's like, I like unconditional. Yeah, no.
Yes, it doesn't.
You're right. What I said, it doesn't. The Markov result doesn't maintain the depth of the circuit. Yeah, so. Sorry? So, I mean, Markov himself was not concerned about any efficiency. So I think that that doesn't even preserve the efficiency of the circuit. It's some sort of. But the later result did do it efficiently. And what did it do? It applied. It didn't do anything to the depth of the circuit, actually. Here's what I remember. You take the input, and you apply some function to it that has these log n negations. And I don't remember how deep that function is, but it's unrelated to f. Exactly. And that's unrelated to the complexity of the other function. And then you plug it in the other function. That's exactly what it is.
The construction that I recall, this is before the improvements you talked about, takes an input string of n bits, and using only log n negations or log n plus 1, produces as output another set of n bits, which are the bitwise negations of the input bits. So you just negate all the input bits. Now you've got dual rail.
This is the improvement I was talking about. Markov's result is not like this. This is an improvement. Maybe it's also old, but it's maybe Fisher or someone else? Fisher, yeah. So that is the improvement I talked about. I don't know what the latest improvement is. So how deep is that? I don't know.
It's probably another instruction.
Yeah, I'll check it. It's definitely in all the, you know, this the Jukna book from has like a good description of all the, and it's recent and with proofs and written very clearly. It's very easy to look up. Like from a few years ago.
Any other questions? We have only 10 minutes. So thank you.
Thanks. Oh, that's not my computer.